this section, which is by Dr. K. Vijay Raghavan on biotechnology, meeting aspirations of growing India. Professor Vijay Raghavan is a secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, since January 2013. Before that, he was the director of the NCBS, the National Center for Biological Sciences of the TIFR, and interim head of the Institute of Stem Cell Biology and Regenerative Medicine, a new autonomous institute with the DBT. His contributions to science as a developmental biologist has been recognized widely. He was conferred an honorary Doctor of Science degree by the University of Edinburgh in 2011. He is a J.C. Bose Fellow of the Department of Science and Technology and delivered the J.C. Bose Memorial Lecture at the Royal Society in 2010. He also has the Infosys Prize in Life Sciences, the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, and a whole range of other prizes and recognitions. He has also been awarded the Padma Shri. It's a great pleasure to have Vijay here. He's been a very close friend, mentor, and sometimes boss over the last many years of my life.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Rana. Now I know it's been a long day and we've been running late, and I stand between you and a terrific talk which will come after mine. Mine's not going to be terrific. So I'll try to be rather brief. One of the nice things about coming just in time supposedly for your talk is you end up hearing the previous two talks which carried on because the schedule was running late. And I really enjoyed listening both to Bairagowda as well as Dr. Devi Shetty, and learned a lot. And the very simple point which comes across relates to what I want to say is the following. We are in an extraordinary area of decision making everywhere where the Indian elite, i.e. those sitting in this room, those sitting in New Delhi, science bureaucrats, have the enormous luxury of having each one of us having veto over every single decision. That is, any one of us can raise any viewpoint whatsoever, irrespective of whether it is rational or not, whether it affects a million people or two people, and our view will be heard. And not only will our view be heard, we will postpone decision making forever and ever until everyone is satisfied. The result of this is Bangladesh will have a vaccination program. Sri Lanka will have a vaccination program of quality. Bhutan will have it. Pakistan is better than us. Afghanistan is better than us. But we must debate whether the side effect of a vaccine, which can save 100,000 lives a year, potentially a side effect of 1 in a million, until we have a regulatory system which can deal with that 1 in a million, should we introduce that vaccine or not? And we will debate year after year after year after year. We will debate about GM technologies, about what they do and what they shouldn't do. We can take a decision one way or the other. We can look at the pluses and minuses, but we'll bring to bear our own ideology from left or right or center and do it. Meanwhile, we will continue to drive on our roads with extraordinary regulation. That is, we will have our licenses got easily. And you know, I was in Delhi a few days ago and a journalist told me she had to get her license renewed after she was 50. She had to get a medical certificate. She went to the RTO, doctor sitting there, ticked everything, you know, medical certificate done in 30 seconds. You have a license to kill, right? This is not a problem. But extraordinary regulatory requirements and demands will be made for something whose dangers are not clear. No matter what the evidence is, it's always presented that there are two sides. It doesn't matter one is correct or one is wrong. We are unable to take decisions. And this is the fundamental problem which we have, and we have the luxury of this problem precisely because there are two countries we live in. One is a France and a Germany, and just like France and Germany, we have the luxury to dictate how the rest of the world will behave, what is right, what is wrong, and so on and so forth. And the other is a sub-Saharan Africa. And we live in a salt and pepper mix of a France and Germany and a sub-Saharan Africa. And the France and Germany we live in does not care about the sub-Saharan Africa. It will debate endlessly about it, and it doesn't care. And this goes across the spectrum. I'm not saying that I care or you don't care and so on. We heard Bairagowda. It goes across the spectrum. Yet there's good news. The good news is there is an amazing capacity for each of us to understand the nature of the problem. You heard this in the last few talks, I mean, which I heard, I'm sure the other talks brought that out. We understand the complexities of the problem, we understand what the possible solutions are, and we need to start implementing it. But we're scared of the huge edifices which need to be broken down, of sloth, of disregard, of lack of speed, and lack of decision making in very important aspects. How do we do that? How do we build new foundations? Big edifices collapse by hitting them at the right place, not by, you know, demanding that they collapse and, you know, asking for a revolution and so on. Eventually they'll collapse. The greater challenge is actually to what does one build out of that? And that requires an understanding of science and society as one of its components, not the only component. Globally, what has happened today is an amazing alienation of science from people. This is coupled with an alienation of government from people. Governments all over the world have become agents of large forces outside of the democracies which elect them. And there's a puzzlement among people that, you know, we elect a government, yet it seems to be, you know, serving interests of other forces. And this is a global problem. In the absence of ideology which stimulates people and links them through those ideologies to government, we have all sorts of difficult ideologies which have, you know, seek to overthrow regimes, but not necessarily tell us how to govern for people in general. And this is a huge problem. So in that context, let me try to tell you two very quick stories. One, I think life sciences, and I come from the Department of Biotechnology of the Government of India, has a very special role to play in this situation. It has a special role to play because in terms of sustainable development on this planet, we have moved from an extraordinary situation to another one where from understanding nature's engineering, we have become the engineers of nature. And this is a very frightening situation. And unless we understand what has happened, we can't change that. The second problem, point is, which I shall address, is this changing the system, as it were, after this understanding, is rather a complex one. The world is a very, very different place than it was 50, 60, or 100 years ago, and therefore this change cannot be brought about just by ideological viewpoints about what is to be done or not, but requires a complex decision-making which will result in complex solutions to complex problems, which will make everyone moderately unhappy, rather than a situation where, you know, we ideologically state this is right or this is wrong, compromises socially, politically will have to be done, and that's a big challenge, but I think it's reasonable. So first of all, let me tell you one quick sentence why life sciences are important. Human health knows no boundaries, our diversity of our planet knows no boundaries, messing up one region in the Amazon or in the Western Ghats can mess up the whole planet, so all of this knows no boundaries. Similarly, food and sustainable development know no boundaries. And therefore, life sciences can play a very important role in a transboundary goal towards a sustainable plan. And that can happen if we work together across countries to deal with issues such as health and agriculture in a manner which really looks at not just human health and human well-being, but the well-being of the planet as a whole. Now, there have been models which have worked in this kind of a venture where a small set of people have had a huge impact on the whole world. One model where the impact was, I think, when you would say extraordinarily negative, was the Manhattan Project during the Second World War, where about five Hungarian physicists who had emigrated due to persecution in Europe went to America, and were the drivers, some of them, behind the Manhattan Project, which made the atomic bomb. Then, post-war, some of these people were very influential in developing the H-bomb during the Cold War. But this was a marriage of science, politics, the armed forces, Cold War, in a manner which actually transformed the world completely. So there are examples of that kind where a small number of people working with science and technology can have a dramatic impact. Another impact, which I regard as extraordinarily positive, and what many of you know about, is the cooperation in Europe, which led to its scientific transformation. After a treaty was signed to allow coal trade to move freely between France and Germany, this was the beginnings of the European Common Market and the European Economic Union. European scientists decided that certain kinds of science are too big for any country to do on its own. And this led to the development of CERN in Geneva, but also in terms of biology, the European Molecular Biology Organization and the European Molecular Biology Laboratories. And this resulted in the overthrowing of the dominance of America in biology by a band of European collaborations, which resulted in quality European scientists coming in through the ENVO and the EMBL to transform European biology. In that similar manner, the problems which we have today in health, in agriculture, can also be addressed by a cooperation emulating this kind of European Molecular Biology Organization into an Asian molecular biology structure, which is much broader in its remit, which not only understands basic science, but also takes them to address complex problems in health and agriculture. Not just Asian, I should say Asian and Africa. And India, because of its capacity in biology today, has the ability to take the lead in this. Whether it has the will to do it or not is another question, but it certainly has the capacity. Now, let me give you a little modestly technical reading of how we have transited from a situation where we understand nature's engineering to how we can actually be nature's engineers. To start off with, about 10,000 years ago, if we took the fraction of the vertebrate biomass which was occupied by humans and their pets and livestock, it was 0.1% of the total vertebrate biomass. Today, humans and their livestock and their pets occupy 98% of the vertebrate biomass, right? We have moved from a situation, as Paul McCready, who I won't elaborate on who he is now, said, we have moved from a situation where one of the objects painted on this canvas of life to actually becoming the painter ourselves. Right? We are transforming the planet by leaps and bounds in every single way, and therefore this is a dramatic change from evolution by natural selection to the planet being pushed depending on what we do. Now, how has this happened in terms of the life sciences? Now, all life on this planet evolved from single cellular organisms at time equal to zero, right? And the bulk of life today, actually, in terms of weight, are those single cellular organisms. But that common origin means that the chemistry of all life on this planet, the metabolism of all life on this planet, is all related to this origin. So we know how any organism works. We can understand it by studying any other organism, because there's a shared chemistry. And the thread of life which connects all of this is nucleic acid, DNA. And DNA actually tells us how we evolved and how our common chemistry amongst all life on this planet is shared. This is absolutely amazing. Scientists first tried to understand all of this, and in trying to understand this complexity, and the people who actually articulated best were Charles Darwin and Alfred Russel Wallace. And looking around at the diversity of life on this planet, Darwin figured that evolution took place by natural selection. And as another evolutionary biologist later put it, Dobzhansky, given enough time, an event, however low a probability, will happen. And given enough time, millions of years, the complexity of life has evolved, right? By chance, something complex evolves. It's selected because of its environment. And from that, more complexity evolves and so on and so forth. What is the molecular basis of this? That came much later. But Gregor Mendel asked, how life varies from generation to generation. Not the whole beauty of species on Earth, but how are our children like us or different from us, how are peas different from the parents, and so on and so forth. And he came upon rules of transmission of characters from generation to generation. So Darwin and Wallace about how diversity on Earth came about, and Mendel about how variation came about from generation to generation. For a long time, these two schools argued about how different these two phenomena were in terms of what underlies them. But the answer is the same, that the same mechanism operates, this common thread of life, and that came from the field of molecular biology, which eventually showed that the genetic material DNA encodes life in its diverse forms, and molecular mechanisms actually make different kinds of plants and animals. What are those molecular mechanisms? And those were studied by a third group, a fourth group called embryologists, who, as a fertilized egg divided to give rise to two cells, four cells, and an animal, took a hot needle, for example, and killed one cell at the two cell stage and asked what happens to the entire animal. If half the animal goes away, they said this cell gave rise to that half, and they did this work in frogs. And they also took cells from one location and put it in another and asked, did it die? Did it become like cells in those locations? Did it control that location? And that these kinds of experiments resulted, like in genetics and in evolution, the proposing of certain kinds of rules about how animals and plants develop. Again, the molecular mechanisms by which these diversity of shapes within an animal or a plant were generated became understood. And again, it's the same mechanism which applies, the same chemistry which applies. So the chemistry of life which creates a given animal form, a huge range of animal or plant forms, or a huge variation from generation to generation is the same chemistry. And that same chemistry, in terms of making humans, for example, is the same chemistry which is used to make a mouse, or a rat, or a dog, or a worm, or a fly. The toolkit, the screwdriver, the rivet, the spanner, and so on and so forth are the same. Where you apply it, how you apply it, results in different forms. You can get a Maruti car, you can get a Rolls Royce, but the principles are exactly the same. And the challenge in biology today is to understand what those diversities of application of these principles are, which gives rise to this diverse form. So that's a very exciting area, which combines to multiple fields, including now computer science. Now, understanding this has led to a huge amount of ways by which we can address practical problems, be they in health or agriculture and so on and so forth. For example, one of the kinds of cancers which we get is a colon cancer, and that often comes in inherited forms of that cancer due to a mutation in a particular gene. And that gene, called WNT, is a gene which is used in the fruit fly to make a wing. And flies which are mutant for that gene don't have a wing. And that gene was discovered in the Indian Agricultural Research Institute in Pusa, in an undergraduate lab. And identifying the gene by trying to understand how flies develop has resulted in identifying a gene which is involved in human cancer, because molecular methods allow you to sequence the gene and find out what is wrong. Illustrating the point that the toolkit to make all life forms is essentially the same. Now this Pandora's box, as it were, and there's no going back, one can all hark back to a nativist age that didn't exist. Our understanding has improved dramatically, and this has resulted in great benefit and great problems. And that's the way life is, whether it's, you know, the discovery of hydrochloric acid has a similar effect, the discovery of molecular biology has had a similar effect. It's not that, you know, any of these tools are intrinsically right or wrong. But this understanding of nature's engineering in the last 5 years has resulted in a dramatic transformation. Till the last 5 or 10 years, actually, our ability to manipulate nature through this understanding was minuscule. You take one gene from one organism, you put it somewhere else and see what happens. You have proper regulation for that and so on and so forth, right? You can make GM food, GM mice, GM humans in principle, which no one does, and so on and so forth. And this has been immensely valuable in some ways, in the drug industry, in the biotech industry, and so on and so forth. But the last 10 years, there's been a dramatic change. Nature's engineering has moved beyond our ability to engineer one or two genes at a time to our ability to engineer entire genomes at the same time. We can engineer metabolic pathways in principle and in practice in some cases to make new kinds of products. There's a new technology called CRISPR in which we can actually induce changes in genes in a manner which doesn't leave any trace of any foreign genetic material coming in. One can make changes in DNA. And so there are extraordinary opportunities for applications, and there are extraordinary potentials for misuse. And the regulatory aspect of these kinds of new technologies is a matter of exciting and important debate. Great caution is needed, there are great opportunities, and it's a very, very complex terrain which people are now going to begin to explore. And in India today, we are debating the merits or demerits of technologies which are essentially obsolete. So there's a new need for a new kind of debate, and that debate has not started. It started in the rest of the world. The US National Academy has just announced a committee to look into regulatory issues of these kinds for these new technologies. So anyway, the point is that we have moved from being in a situation where we understand nature to a situation where we have become nature's engineers. But there's another problem, and I'd like to end with that, is this extraordinary situation in society today that you will have someone come in to a room with a viewpoint using the latest in science and technology and the latest in your iPad or any other application, and will have a very strong view about something or the other. It could be a view which is very utilitarian about these technologies and how, you know, I as a corporate CEO will do this or that, or how I as an activist will do something else, or a social scientist something else, and so on. All these categories of people will be using the latest in technology. And the difference between today and 100 years ago is, 100 years ago, if you opened up the technological tools you were using, your watch or your steam engine or whatever, you could explain its function to anyone without too much difficulty. The principles of physics and engineering and biology were evident on opening up your watch or your car, right? That is no longer so. You lift up your iPad today and you open it, it's, what's it all about? You open the bonnet of your car, you cannot understand it anymore. It's all electronics, largely. This kind of a move from our understanding intuitively of the function of technology has led to a great fear. And this great fear has led to a situation where society is disconnected with science and technology. This has resulted in an extraordinary misuse of technology by large organizations without understanding them, and an extraordinary misuse of technology by smaller organizations, activists, people, societies in rich and poor countries who will say no to a technology because of this fear, right? Scientists can kick and scream saying this is safe or not safe and so on, but they are pushed, without their desire to be pushed, into one ideological camp or the other, right? For example, I was talking to a colleague, a friend, about GM crops right now. And this term GM is used as if it's one thing. Now GM, as I told you, because we know not only about nature's engineering, but we can engineer nature now, is 2,456 different things, or you know, a zillion more. You have to ask, what is the science you're talking about? What is the gene you put in? How have you put it in? Where have you put it in? To say whether it's safe or not. To say whether GM is safe or not is like asking, is the wheel safe or not? Depends. You put it in a battle tank, it's slightly risky, right? You put it in an ambulance, it's safe, right? So these kinds of poor communication about science pushes scientists who say GM is safe into the camp of X or Y or Z, right? You are responsible for killing farmers. You are an agent of multinationals, yeah? Or some such thing. Or if you say it's not safe, then another bunch will say, you know, how do you say this? Similar with nuclear power. Is nuclear power safe or not, right? It's a complex question. My point is, these debates, all too often, scientists try to settle it by getting upset, as I often do, at the poor understanding of science, of others, without us for a moment introspecting and say that our communication of science is extraordinarily poor. we don't engage with the community in science to a level which this debate becomes rational, calm, and allows different kinds of viewpoints to be seen, right? And this is because of multiple complex reasons. The way technology has changed is complex, but it requires, it's all the more reason why science communication should be extremely important. And that communication needs to go multiple ways, from society to scientists, from scientists to politicians, politicians to industrialists, and back and forth. And unless this happens, we are in great danger. We are ruled by a country where decisions are ruled by people in a country where decisions are taken democratically even now. But I know for certain, in a group of bureaucrats who have to take a complex decision right now, the simplest decision to take is to have another committee and to postpone the decision. I will retire in a year and a half, right? I will wash my hands and go away. This is not my case, said Herod. Yeah? And he moved away. This is not my case, is what every bureaucrat does. And every bureaucrat who postpones the introduction of a legitimate vaccine program, who postpones the decision to introduce something which is valuable for our agriculture, has blood on his or her hands. And unless we realize this, and unless we integrate India and Bharat, we are not doing ourselves any favors at all. We can't keep on talking. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Share with the audience here one particular issue of